Good afternoon and welcome to another edition of the show. It is the Thursday edition, the 14th day of July, and there's so much to be thankful for considering that we're exactly 2 weeks into the month of July. Welcome, this is The Arena, and I'm Samson Oluide. There's so much in store for you today, you know, on the show, so we'll just delve into it as quickly as we can. Olamilekan, yes, thanks for joining me once again. What do you make of it? The first match we lost to South Africa, we didn't play too well, but the girls recovered well over the last two games, although you want to also question the kind of opposition in terms of the quality. But do you think they have what it takes to get the job done over Cameroon and, you know, book a place at the World Cup?
Like I said, it's a matter of the urgency and the desire to actually qualify for the semi-finals, because when we talk of quality, we have that quality.
Okay.
But looking at us against South Africa, we were not clinical as we should be. So I think losing chances against Cameroon will probably not make us get it, because against the last match that we went 4-0,
yes,
we could have gone 8-0,
exactly,
because we lost a lot of chances.
We were not ruthless.
So those kind of chances, and if you won't get as much chances against Cameroon.
Yes.
So it depends on how clinical they can be in that match.
Okay, but you think Asisa Oshoala's injury loss won't be a problem here? Because against Cameroon, you need your best legs.
Of course, it's a problem. Asisa Oshoala is like probably one of the best
strikers,
Nigerian strikers that we have. So I think it's a problem, but the way they have been able to manage in the last two games is good, and they had the last two games to actually even plan and see how they can play without her for it. So I think they should be fine.
Okay, let's see how that pans out. And we'll still have to talk about, you know, the Women's African Cup of Nations ongoing in Morocco. The other match we'll have later today is that of South Africa against Tunisia. On paper, it looks like South Africa all the way when you consider, you know, the quality of both sides, especially in terms of this competition, the precedence. But you never can tell. Football could just, you know, spring up the upsets. South Africa, looking at, you know, testing their title credentials against Tunisia, as well as booking a place at the World Cup. You think the Bayana, as they are called, will get it done?
On paper, like you said, on paper, it's like a free pass. But these things happen in this kind of quarterfinals, in this kind of games. You see these kind of things that you think that they can't really put a challenge,
exactly,
suddenly becomes taking the team probably into extra time, into penalties, and sometimes as luck might have it, they might win. So I'm giving it South Africa, but like, who knows, football.
Okay,
football.
Making use of the last game, we saw South Africa against Botswana that ended by a lone goal. Not necessarily a struggle overall, but in terms of the scoreline, they didn't have clear cut chances, you know, to really exert their dominance as they would have expected. You think Tunisia will probably close up shop, you know, coming into this?
Yes, like I said, I think it could go into an extra time, because South Africa, looking at their games, they were able to use their chances. That's one thing I know. They were able to, but they didn't get much chances. So going against a very defensive team, or probably a very strong defensive team, will be a very big problem for them. So we'll see how it goes.
Okay, let's still talk about women's football, but this time around, you know, we have to focus now on the Euros. It's taking place in England, and it's already drawing record attendance in terms of the fans to the stadium. Remember that England against Austria, the opening match, had over 68,000 fans. And for women's football, this is a very good time. Do not forget Barcelona against Wolfsburg in the Women's Champions League last season pulled 91,000 plus fans to the Nou Camp. So it shows you that women's football is on the rise at this point in time. But to the matches we have today for, you know, the women's Euros, you have Italy against Iceland, and that's where we'll start from. The Italians are looking to bounce back from that horrific showing, you know, humiliation it was against France. Italy, Iceland, first half of that France game, I don't know what happened. There were five goals down even before halftime, but they were still able to steady the ship. Or maybe France just, you know, relaxed in the second half. This time around, they're seeking redemption against Iceland. Can they get it done?
Yes, they would. They would, because that kind of humiliation, that kind of embarrassment always will fuel their desire. They would just want to get on, just get all the 3 points that they need in that match. So I think they should win.
But looking at Iceland, you don't think they'll probably pose one or two problems for the Italians? Again, as much as they can feel, you know, that desire to go all the way out and get something. Mm-hmm. It can also dent their confidence. So it's a two-way thing, really.
Yes, yes, of course, it's a two-way thing. But Italians are, I don't know probably what happened to them in that last match.
Just a superior opposition.
So I hope, or I think they will go on to
get it. Okay, let's see how that pans out. You have another match talking about France against Belgium. The women's Euros for France, they'll be seeking to, you know, book their place in the quarterfinals of the Euro 2020 with a win over Belgium. France, confidence, you know, 5-1 against Italy. Grace Guerrero with a hat-trick last time out. This time around, it's against Belgium. Not a dominant football side when it comes to the women's game, but can also pull surprises. You expect France to win and go through?
Yes, I expect France to win, but it's not going to be a freeway for them. Because Belgium has been, they have been also good too. I think from qualification to this tournament.
Yes.
So I think Belgium will actually pose like a 2-1, like a 2-1 match, like just a goal difference.
Not the kind of blowout scoreline we saw.
No, not.
But for the women's Euros, we've seen some blowout scorelines. I mean, England struggled against Austria to win by lone goal. And then Norway that had Ada Hegerberg, former Ballon d'Or winner, 8-0. What's it with women's game? I won't say inconsistency in terms of how, you know, teams pose challenges to one another, but it seems like you can't be too sure how close a game will be or how open it will be.
It's really, I don't know. I think probably it deals with their mentality. Probably when they are 2-3 up and they probably give up and be like, okay, the match has ended. I think that should probably happen because going 8, it's a lot of goals in a match.
I know it's early days, but who are you looking at? Maybe 2-3 teams. The Netherlands are defending champions, but you have England who are quite impressed, you know, who were quite impressive in their last outing. There's France in the mix as well. Do not forget, you still have Sweden, Germany, you know. Mm-hmm. So who are you looking at to win the Euros?
France.
Okay.
France, Germany, and England.
Okay, those three.
Those three.
Okay. Octopus Olaleko has spoken. Let's see if that comes to pass. In the world of football, Atletico Madrid has confirmed a multi-year shirt sponsorship deal with cryptocurrency exchange platform Willfin, worth $42.3 million annually. Willfin will take over from trading platform Plus500 at the start of the 2022-2023 season, following the expiration of the Israel-based company's contract this off-season. Plus500 reportedly paid $17 million per year. Willfin's parent company, the Amber Group, will be a digital world partner of Atletico Madrid. The deal also includes branding at Estadio Metropolitano, Atletico's home field since 2017. Atletico is the 13th most valuable football club in the world, valued at $1.5 billion, according to Forbes, and has had successes on the pitch, finishing third in the Spanish La Liga this past season and being crowned champions in 2021. The club has also generated $396 million in revenue in 2022, up from $368 million in 2021. However, Atletico has an operating income of only $45 million, compared to $62 million last year. Still talking football, and it's all about, you know, sponsorships at this time. Italian top-flight football club Sampdoria have extended their main shirt sponsorship agreement with Banca Ifis for the 2022-2023 Serie A season. The deal, worth a reported 1.05 million euros last season, will see the bank retain prime inventory on the shirts of the Sampdoria men's and women's teams. Banca Ifis will also gain visibility across Sampdoria's training apparel for the men's first team, as well as a package of club inventory, including LED boards, backdrops, and digital assets. Still talking football, this time around in the Spanish La Liga. La Liga and Santander have announced that they will end their title sponsorship deal for the elite tiers of Spanish football after the 2022-2023 season. La Liga says the partnership, which was first signed in 2016, was curtailed as the result of a joint decision to explore new ways of collaboration. La Liga says it will announce further details on its naming rights from the 2023-2024 season over the coming weeks. Last year, the league signed a two-year extension worth around 20 million euros a year, which will see the deal cut through to its conclusion. Now, in the world of basketball, Milwaukee Bucks guard Pat Connaughton has agreed on a 3-year, $28.5 million extension with a player option, and this is coming according to his agents, Jeff Schwartz, as well as Jordan Gettler. Now, on Tuesday, Connaughton's total deal is now worth 4 years and worth a reported $34 million. He had previously exercised this option to return for the 2022-2023 season. Connaughton enjoyed his best season this past year, posting career highs in points 9.5, minutes 26.5, and three-point percentage 39.5%. After missing a month of the season due to a hand injury, Connaughton returned for the stretch run and helped an injured Milwaukee team advance to the second round of the playoffs.